Well, let me thank you all for coming, and let me thank the Chicago Humanities Festival for inviting me. I hope you realize what a precious asset this is for the city of Chicago. Coming from New York, where we don't have something like this, I begin to realize what a wonderful thing this is to be able to bring people together and just enjoy the sheer fun of thinking about intellectual exercises. I wish we could get people in New York to do it. Let me tell you just a couple of minutes about how I came to write this book and why I think it may be of some use in thinking about what not just the First Amendment, but the Bill of Rights and the entire Constitution, but we'll focus on the Bill of Rights this afternoon. In the 1990s, I had a wonderful assistant who came to me and said, "Professor Neuborne, I'm so tired of you writing down all your work on yellow pads. Isn't it possible for you to learn how to use the computer? Because if you learn how to use the computer, then I won't have to type the drafts up all the time, I'll be more productive, you'll be more productive." And I said, "Lonnie, I just can't do it. I'm too old. I'm not going to be able to master the typing. I just can't do it." And she said, "Well, you know, I'm going to do you a favor." I said, "What kind of a favor are you going to do me?" She said, "I'm not typing your stuff anymore." And I said, no, you don't understand. I'm the boss. You have to type the stuff." She said, "No, I'm not typing your stuff anymore. And I know you're too soft to do anything about it," which of course was true. I was forced to try to learn the computer. And I worked on, in those years, it was WordPerfect that I was trying to learn. So I took a laptop out to the on my summer vacation, and I'm typing away. And I'm at the point where I want to learn how to highlight and move text. I'm highlighting the text. And so what do? I type out the Bill of Rights. I just type the Bill of Rights out. And I decide that I'm going to highlight the text and start moving it around so that will help me learn how to do it. Every single time I did it and moved a piece of the Bill of Rights to somewhere else in the Bill of Rights, it seemed wrong. It didn't seem to be in the right place. And I thought to myself, well, that's because I'm so used to seeing it that way. And then I realized, no, of course that's not true. I've never read the damn thing from start to finish anyway. So it can't be because it's habitual. Could it possibly be that there is a deep underlying story below the Bill of Rights that is told by the organization, by the fact that the First Amendment comes first and the Fourth comes fourth and it comes before the Fifth but after the Third? In other words, is there a deep structure to the text itself, which if we read it the way we read a poem or read a great work of aesthetic art, if we spent that attention on the text of the Constitution itself, especially the First Amendment, would we be able to see things there that we don't otherwise see? And I began to work on that idea. Now, recognize that at the time I did this, and today, nobody really reads the Constitution. Nobody. Not the Supreme Court, not the lower court judges, not the lawyers. They read pieces of it. They read words. But nobody reads it as a single coherent document. I would say, apart from the lucky students in Will's class and somebody at Stanford and somebody at Yale, no American law student graduates without having actually read the whole text. And that's true not just of the Constitution itself, it's true of the Bill of Rights. Nobody sits down and reads all 10 amendments in order. Or the First Amendment, the 45 words in the First Amendment, the 6 clauses in the First Amendment. Nobody sits down and reads it as a whole. Instead, we pull words and phrases out. The freedom of speech, establishment of religion, the commerce clause, unreasonable search and seizure. And we take the pieces, those small pieces, and put them into intellectual silos. And try to derive meaning from it without thinking about the place in the larger document from which we've drawn it. Indeed, we treat the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and the First Amendment as though the founders took a pot of ink and threw it at the wall. And the splatter is what organized the document. So that there isn't a reason why it begins, why the First Amendment, there's no reason why the Bill of Rights begins with the First Amendment. There's no reason why the First Amendment begins with the Establishment Clause. It's just there, and we pull them out randomly, and we deal with it. What I want to suggest to you is that there's a different way of reading it. Let's just concentrate on the First Amendment. I'll bet, and I don't mean this pejoratively, because the answer is nobody does it. Try to think of the last time you read the First Amendment, the single most important political text in our lives, the thing that we deeply believe in and we hope keeps us free. When's the last time you actually sat down and read it? Read all 45 words. Now, a group like this that supports something like the Chicago Humanities Festival is the intellectual cream of any society. If you're not reading it, who is? Not my students, I'll tell you that. So let me read it to you. And if I do nothing else this afternoon, having read the First Amendment to you, I can go home and think I did something. The First Amendment, the 45 words of the First Amendment are six clauses, 45 words. I'm going to hesitate after each clause so that you can get some sense of how they fit together. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for redress of grievances. 45 words. Now, we can't read it literally. I mean, when I try to read it literally, it absolutely resists literal reading, because it starts with Congress. You don't want the First Amendment just to limit Congress. You want it to limit the president. You want it to limit the army. We eventually want it to limit governors, local police forces. So if you want to say Congress, you've got a real problem with the literal. Then it says, shall make no. We don't mean no. We mean almost no. Because threats can be prohibited, extortion can be prohibited, blackmail can be prohibited. Just because you happen to exercise your vocal cords and speak doesn't mean it's absolutely protected. So they can't mean no. There's something more there. And then it says law. Well, that's no good. We want it to be more than law. We want it to govern regulations. We want it to govern the cop on the beat when the cop makes a discretionary judgment that isn't codified in a statute. So it's got to be more than law. And then we want to say respecting an establishment of religion. Let's assume you could figure out what that is. But then it says abridging the freedom of speech. The freedom of speech. Doesn't say abridging speech. Then maybe we could read it literally. It doesn't even say abridging freedom of speech. It says abridging the freedom of speech. The freedom of speech is a concept. It's a man-made concept. And we have to decide what's inside of it and what's outside of it. There's no dictionary that will answer that question. So that a literal reading of the text is no good. It turns out that a historical reading of the text is not very useful either. The ink wasn't dry on the First Amendment before John Adams locked up most of the newspaper editors who opposed him in the election of 1800. Benjamin Franklin's grandnephew, Benjamin Franklin Bache, died in jail because Adams locked him up because he was the editor of a newspaper that opposed him. In 1806, Thomas Jefferson, the great apostle of freedom, began a seditious libel action against somebody for criticizing him too vigorously. The 19th century was a free speech disaster. Abolitionist presses were burned and riots all over the North. Discussion of slavery was forbidden in most of the Southern states. Lincoln locked people up during the Civil War for opposing the war. In the period afterwards, labor leaders were locked up in droves for attempting to organize strikes and other forms of economic activity. opponents to World War I spent an enormous amount of time in jail. Eugene Debs polled over 1 million votes for president in 1921 from his cell in the penitentiary, where he was sentenced for giving a speech in 1917 opposing the war. And when they released him in 1921, he was forbidden from ever speaking, voting, or running for office again. The 1930s were again a First Amendment disaster, with labor leaders being arrested. The McCarthy period after the Second World War was terrible. It wasn't until the 1960s that we begin to see the beginning of what we think of as the modern First Amendment, a really muscular protection of dissent and free speech. So if we look at it historically, unless we want to erase it, it's not a very good place to look. So how should we look at it? Can we look at it, what about its purpose? Is it about free market and ideas? It is about human dignity? Is it about mistrust of government? It's about all those things. The trouble is, all those things are at a level of generality that they just don't answer hard, specific questions about how the amendment should be applied. So if it can't be read literally, and historically it doesn't work, and purposefully it reaches all sorts of different results, how should we read it? How can we read it? And this is my suggestion. My suggestion is that if you look at it not through the eyes of purpose, not digging up, you know, disinterring long dead white men and asking them what they thought, if you actually look at the text itself, the six clauses I read you, and you look at the 42 rights-bearing documents that existed in our history, starting with the Magna Carta, and we celebrate its 800th anniversary this year, starting with the Magna Carta, going through the English Bills of Rights, going through the colonial charters, going through the various Bills of Rights of the states, going into the Declaration of the Rights of Man, you look at all of those documents, and you find that the First Amendment is unique. It is the only textual document that unites the six ideas that are the core of each clause. The Establishment Clause is freedom from religion. It protects us against people getting control of the government and using the government to ram down their religious beliefs on other people. So it's freedom from religion. Then it's freedom of religion. Then it's freedom of speech. Then it's freedom of the press. Then it's freedom of assembly. And then it's freedom to petition. Those six ideas have never been united in a single text before or since, and never in the order in which Madison and his colleagues put them. If you think about it for a moment, there's a reason why we start with the religion clauses. That's conscience. That's the interior sense of a person's belief, the core of a person's belief. Madison wanted a third clause. He tried to put a secular conscience clause in there as well. He got it through the House, but the Senate took it out. So that the First Amendment begins with two clauses dealing with conscience. Then you move forward to speech, then press, then assembly, then petition. Think about this for a moment. It is the arc of a democratic idea. The First Amendment is a narrative statement of the operation of a robust egalitarian democracy. It is the city on the hill that the founders hoped to create, and the single most important document that they produced is the document that tells the story of the flow of a democratic idea. Begins in the conscience of a free person. And that's why the First Amendment begins with protection of conscience. Once you've generated an idea within your free conscience, the next thing you want to do is speak. You want to articulate the idea. That's why speech comes after conscience. Conscience first, speech second. But I've spoken most of my life, and I haven't spoken to enough people to change anybody's mind. If I really want to speak to people and have them change their mind, I have to get some way to disseminate my speech to a mass audience. And that's where press comes in. So after you speak, then the next clause in the First Amendment is the protection of a mass dissemination mechanism that will get the idea out to the general public. Then once the idea is out in the general public, the next thing that you do in the arc of a democratic idea, in the narrative of democracy, is collective action in support of the idea. And that's why assembly comes after press. It couldn't come anywhere else. It couldn't come before press, because how can you assemble until the idea is out among the people in a mass way so that there's something for them to assemble around? And then in 1958, Justice Harlan dropped a non-textual seventh right into the First Amendment. He dropped association in at that point as well. There's no textual support for association in the First Amendment. But Harlan realized that in the years since the founding, what had been the important collective action mechanism, which are people actually coming together, physically assembling, that our forms of communication had so dramatically changed that it was possible for us to virtually assemble without actually coming together physically. And that's what he called association. So you associate virtually. So there's collective action, and then once you have collective action, you then move to the sixth and final textual idea, which is petition. You then take that idea, you go to the government, and you demand that they enact it. If you were to shuffle the cards and shuffle up those six clauses, the way they are in most other places, the way they are, for example, in many state constitutions or in the Declaration of the Rights of Man, you wouldn't get anything like the narrative clarity of the story of democracy that is in the First Amendment. So my plea to you is that when you go home tonight, go online, call up the First Amendment, indeed call up the Bill of Rights, the entire Bill of Rights, read it, but read it as a story. Don't read it as a series of isolated, unconnected norms. It's hard enough for us to get the story right. It's impossible for us to get the norms right unless we realize that they're part of some overarching narrative. And I'll just give you one example. The one example is the appalling, appalling relationship between the modern First Amendment and democracy. The First Amendment should be democracy's best friend. It is the narrative, it is the story of how democracy works. And instead, the Supreme Court, by insisting on pulling out just a clause, they look at speech, freedom of speech, and they read freedom of speech as an autonomy norm that creates a kind of autonomous ability to do anything you want, even if it hurts democracy, even if it comes close to destroying democracy. And so instead of being democracy's best friend, they read the First Amendment as democracy's bad parent, as a parent that disciplines democracy in ways that make it impossible for democracy to act effectively. We could not ever have developed a campaign finance system that is close to the appalling system we have now, where 158 families, literally 158 families, dominate the political process by putting enormous amounts of money into the system, rendering the rest of us second-class citizens, rendering the rest of us people who essentially respond to the agenda and the candidates that a very small number of people, based solely on wealth, have made available to us. There is no way that you could read the First Amendment as protecting corporations' ability to spend unlimited amounts of money in order to influence the democratic process. There is no way you could read the First Amendment as saying that there are no limits whatever on the ability of the wealthy to control the process. There is no way you could read the First Amendment as saying that people could be disenfranchised because they don't happen to have a birth certificate, because they're poor and they come from cultures that don't have those documents, or that we could have gerrymandering, which has completely eliminated the idea of competitive elections from our legislative life. 435 members of the House in any given year, we're lucky if there are 40 contestable elections among those 435. The lines have been drawn with such care and with such effectiveness that it is virtually impossible to oust an incumbent member of the House who has the good sense to draw the lines so that he or she can't be beaten. Now, If we were to go back and say to Madison, look at the democracy that we've built using a kind of isolated silo reading of the First Amendment, a democracy in which fewer than half of the people vote, a democracy in which we can disenfranchise or make it harder for people to vote, a democracy where we have essentially eliminated competitive elections from our life, a democracy where it is impossible to organize third parties effectively, a democracy where it is now clear that wealth is playing a massively disproportionate role in our political process. If you were to show that to Madison, he would weep. He would weep for our modern democracy. And he would say to you, as I'm saying to you, how could you have taken my clause? That is a hymn to democracy. That is the story of democracy. That is the narrative of democracy. How could you have taken that clause and flipped it to the point where it's become democracy's enemy and not its friend? So I'm sure that many of you will disagree vigorously with what I've said. I hope you will. Will and I have, Will, I know Will when he was even younger than he is now, when he was a student at Stanford, and I was visiting out there and was struck by his brilliance. And now that he's at Chicago, I'm delighted that he's going to have an opportunity to comment and perhaps disagree with much of what I've said.
Okay. Thank you, Burt. So I don't know how much we disagree and how much I just have a lot of questions. I have to say, I found reading this book delightful for a lot of the reasons Burt says. So I teach constitutional law, and the very first assignment I give my students is to read the Constitution. It's their assignment before we even get to class. I say, you know, before the first day, read the Constitution. And then I show up and I call on them and start asking them questions about what they've read. And inevitably, there are several people whose reaction is sort of, you know, you were serious? You know, you actually wanted us to read the Constitution? And then, you know, you slowly try to walk them through it and see how much it says about things that we might have forgotten and how much even sort of provisions that you think are clear or, you know, aren't useful anymore, still can be. I was trying to figure out why is that, and, you know, why is it so few people have read it, why is it so few people think it's relevant, and I was struck by some of what Burt was saying. I think some people have this intuition that, you know, they look at this old text, and they quickly see the words don't seem to make sense in, like, a literal way, and if they know anything about history, they may know that historically, it seems sort of out of step with us, right? So you pick up the First Amendment, and the first thing Burt tells us is, well, you can't pay any attention to the first five words, Congress and no and law. And so you get worried, like, maybe this isn't that useful. And then you think more about it, and you realize that for 150 years, we didn't interpret the First Amendment very well, so we can't learn that much from the history either. So then a part of what people may become worried about is, so at that point, in what sense do we still care about the text? So actually, I wondered if I could get Burt to say a little bit more about that. That if we aren't using the words in the way a lawyer might think of what you use the words for, and we're really, our history of the important stuff in the First Amendment starts in 1960, then, you know, is this really Madison's music? I mean, in what sense are we really getting out of it something that he put in it, as opposed to just something that we've sort of invented for ourselves today?
Well, that's a fair question. The fair question is, when I say there's a story there, that there's a reason why it starts with conscience and ends with petition, and that if you know the story, it will help you read the components of the story more richly. The way, for example, you would read a Wallace Stevens poem. I begin my book with one of my favorite poems, which is a Wallace Stevens a poem called The House Was Quiet and the World Was Calm, which is Stevens' great poem about the mystery and wonder of reading, about how we read and what a magnificent concept that is. But it's fair to say, well, then really isn't all you're asking for is a license to put into the text what you want to take out of it? And that the story that you put into the text is a story that will instrumentally cause the text to be read the way you like it, and not read the way someone else will would read it. And perhaps that's true. I mean, you know, no one who knows anything about my career, I didn't serve as national legal director of the ACLU during the Reagan years, and as the founding legal director of the Brennan Center, I didn't litigate all those constitutional cases because I don't care about outcomes. I am an instrumentalist, and I do care, and I'm always trying to move toward outcomes that I like. But I was genuinely trying in this book to talk about a new way of reading the text that might reach results that I don't always like, but that I think is much richer than taking a single piece of it and reading it. I think Will would agree that reading single pieces of it is hard. I mean, he has a very sophisticated idea of originalism and moving back, and it's worth thinking about that. But my own sense of it is that unless, precisely because the text resists literal and historical reading, unless we want to say judges can do anything they want, and maybe that's true. I mean, maybe the dirty little secret about American constitutional democracy is that judges are just the third house of the legislature, and they do anything they damn want with the text, and there's nothing anybody can do about it. I hope that's not true, because if so, it says troublesome things about our democracy, and I don't think it has to be true. So what I'm trying to find a way is how to constrain a judge, but still leave the judge with some creative capacity, not to be forced into confrontation with a single word or a single phrase and impose a meaning on it, but to have some help in thinking about what that phrase should mean. And I think locating that phrase in a larger narrative of the entire document will give a strong hint to a principal judge about what the phrase should mean. So that I think speech, for example, in the First Amendment, if you read the free speech clause in the First Amendment as one component of a functioning democracy with conscience, speech, press, collective action, and petition being the components of a functioning democracy, that'll help me decide what's inside the freedom of speech and what's outside the freedom of speech. And you know what? There will be people who will come to conclusions that I don't like, but it is at least, I think, a more constrained way of doing it than the way we do it now.
Thank you. So I was trying, as you were talking about the themes in the Supreme Court's cases and this sort of obsession with autonomy rather than democracy, I was trying to think about, you know, is there something in the text that sort of could be said for that, I wondered. So, I don't think the court's opinions, I'll be the first to say, don't say this, they haven't met Burt's challenge. But I was wondering, maybe it is actually the beginning. So what is it that unites all these rights and liberties in the First Amendment? What unites them all is the prohibition at the very beginning of the First Amendment. Congress shall make no law. And now we know, as Burt says, that can't be literal, right? It's not just Congress, it's other branches of the government. It's not just law, it's other kinds of regulations. But maybe that opening line in such sort of negative terms is supposed to be a sign that the real purpose of this is censorship, is government intervention, is the government messing with things. Right. So if there's problems in our democracy that come from each other or even from the marketplace, those might be bad, but maybe not the First Amendment's problems. But what this amendment is really afraid of is the government. Is that a theme that you see there?
Well, that's fair. I mean, there's no doubt. I don't think. I mean, I tried to do a little count on the way out here this morning because I thought maybe it would be relevant on how many First Amendment cases I've actually litigated in the 55 years I've been practicing, and I came up with something in the vicinity of about 275 First Amendment cases over the years, and at the core of most of them is exactly what you say, an idea that people are, individuals should be free from the dead hand of the state, that the state constrains our dignity, it constrains our ability to act, and that the whole purpose of a constitution, after all, is to limit the ability of state to interfere in certain areas where they're forbidden from doing it. And the First Amendment is a very carefully organized prohibition on the state interfering in our religious life, in our communicative life, and in our political life. So that it is there's no question about that. But if that's all we wanted to do, then we could have had a First Amendment that consisted only of the first three clauses. We could have had a First Amendment that said, don't mess around, no establishment of religion, don't mess around with the free exercise of religion, and don't mess around with freedom of speech. Because that's the stuff that is just really interior to the autonomous nature of human dignity. But there are three more clauses. They didn't stop there. They put three more clauses in. They put a press clause in, they put a collective action clause in there, and they put a petition clause. Additional clauses, the fourth through the sixth clauses, those are clauses about hearers, not speakers. The press clause is designed to allow mass dissemination so that hearers get to hear what I have spoken or what some person has spoken, far beyond the capacity of a single person's voice to be able to do it. It magnifies the voice. Now, that helps the speaker, but it also helps the hearer. It creates the audience. Collective action is all about the hearers. The hearers have gotten the idea, and then they want to do something about it. Collective action is not somebody standing alone and Prometheus raging at the gods all by himself. Collective action is the community, having heard Prometheus rage, deciding that they're going to do something about it. So it is collective action and not individual action. And the petition clause, which is formal interaction with the government. And if I had my way, although I think it's a radical way and it's not likely to happen soon, when Justice Harlan dropped freedom of association into the First Amendment in 1958 as a seventh non-textual right, I ask myself, are there other non-textual rights hiding in the white spaces of the First Amendment, just waiting, you know, hiding in plain sight, just waiting to be discovered? And the one I find right after petition is the right to vote. Because one of the embarrassments of our Constitution is it doesn't have any protection of the right to vote. The most important charter of democratic governance in the world. And it doesn't have any independent protection of the right to vote. I would find it in the interstices of the First Amendment, just the way Justice Harlan found free association in those interstices. So that my long-winded answer to Will is that autonomy is enormously important, but so is community. So is the fact that the autonomous being is centered not entirely alone, off by himself on an isolated, alienated island. The autonomous being is part of a larger community to whom she speaks in a way that will help that community organize to govern themselves in a democratic way. So the First Amendment is both autonomy and democracy. It has within it individualism, but it also has within it, I think, community.
Thank you. So community is actually the next thing I was thinking about. So one of the many ways people have of getting together is to create organizations like the ACLU, like the New York Times, like the Coca-Cola Corporation. And one of the most controversial questions in the First Amendment today has become what kinds of rights those communities called corporations have. So if you're right that community is this sort of the big emphasis of the second verse of the First Amendment, does that tell us that cases like Citizens United, which give corporations a constitutional right to produce videos and speak in elections, does it tell us those are right because they recognize the importance of community against the government?
Well, you ask a hugely important question. I mean, we live in a world now in which corporations have become so hugely important, not only in our economic lives, but in our social and political lives, that we're now trying desperately to integrate the idea of a corporation, of an abstract entity called a corporation, into many, many things. Last term, the court had to decide whether corporations had religious beliefs. The term before that, whether corporations had political rights. I got into some trouble because I published something in The Nation magazine a couple of years ago that I never thought they'd publish because it was a joke. It was a joke that I was making. I said, look, you know, the way things are going, I would love to find a way to get adopted by a corporation. I think that would make my life a lot better if I could look up and say, hi, Dad, and it would be General Motors or something like that. I said, if that won't work, then maybe I could marry one. That's good. How many English novels are built around trying to find a wealthy woman to marry? So I'll try to find a wealthy corporation to marry. It'll be the same thing. I said, but until that happens, we just better get used to being screwed by them. Only I didn't use screwed. And I did it on purpose because I wanted to stress the fact that only anthropomorphic beings can screw. Trees don't, and neither do corporations. And neither should they have religious or speech rights, because those who didn't, those are dignitary. They're dignitary rights. They're rights that we have because of the inherent dignity of the human spirit. And we should defend those rights because defending the inherent dignity of the human spirit is what this nation really is about. But corporations don't have dignity. They're enormously important as ways of organizing wealth to be able to efficiently exploit and operate effectively in a market economy. And I was saying to Will when Jackson in 1832 made corporations, before 1832, corporations were only available to rich, influential people who could persuade the legislature to pass a special law authorizing a corporation. Jacksonian democracy argued everybody should be able to take a corporation off the rack. It shouldn't be something that only the rich and powerful have. Anybody should do it. And the role of the corporation in making possible 19th century economic miracle that was the United States, and the growth of the engine of prosperity that we all enjoy every day is unfathomable. It's hard to imagine the world without it. But they are economic beings. They're economic creatures. They're not creatures of dignity. And therefore, it seems to me that the courts went down the wrong path. Now, Will's question, though, is more subtle than that. Will's question is, yes, 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 but when we give them speech rights, they then exercise them, and ordinary people hear it. And therefore, ordinary people are getting more information than they would get if we didn't let the corporation speak. And I'm sympathetic with that. I have no problem saying that ordinarily corporations can publish books, they can speak, they can defend what they do. But ordinarily a corporation should do whatever it wants. I simply get off the train when it comes to the spending of unlimited amounts of money to influence the outcome of elections. Because there I worry that what you're doing is moving from speech to almost a kind of indoctrination. If one party, Justice Brennan, in what I think, I loved Brennan, and it was one of the great joys of my life that I was able to work with him a little bit, and I helped found the Brennan Center because I care so deeply about him. But he made a terrible mistake in a case called Buckley versus Vallejo, which is when he said that spending money in a political context is exactly the same as speaking. That there's a one-to-one relationship between speech and spending. He could never have done that if he thought about the First Amendment as a democracy phenomenon. It was only because he was thinking about speech in an isolated way that he went down that road. But he had a metaphor in which he attempts to defend it. And his metaphor was this. His metaphor was, speech, and this is speech by corporations or speech by very wealthy people. Speech is like fuel in a tank, in a car's gas tank. And you can only drive the car as far as you can put fuel in the tank. And therefore, the money that puts the fuel in the tank is so integratively integrated with the actual speech that we should treat the money, since it's enabling, as the speech itself. And ordinarily, I think that metaphor is right. But what he overlooked was that elections are not a drive in the country. Elections are a race, and a race in which one side has all the fuel, and the other side is scrambling to get enough gas to get off the starting line, is not a race that's worth watching. It's certainly not a race that's worth voting in. His metaphor, I think, simply confused the issue. Yes, corporations are enormously important engines of speech, and I want them to exercise that. But I don't want them to exercise it in the context of a political campaign in which they will exercise undue influence because they will be able to outspend anybody else. If you look at the pool of money available to corporate America, the pool of money available to corporate America dwarfs the ability of anyone to contest that. What I worry about, it hasn't happened yet. I must say, corporations have been rather modest in taking advantage of Citizens United. But it's each year a little bit more, a little bit more, and within five, it will just be natural for them to be spending everything they can to win the elections. And that is simply not a political system that I think any of us, would want to live in.
There's a particular special kind of corporation you talk about here, which is the press. So the New York Times is a corporation. Fox is a corporation. It runs Fox News. And I'm wondering, does the same logic apply there? Would you say, in general, of course, the press should be left free from government regulation, but sometimes if the government gets too worried that, say, Fox News is distorting the picture we get in democracy because of its wealth, or the New York Times, or whichever one, that the government could step in and sort of correct the media being wrong?
Great question. Inside the ACLU, that's known as the Rupert Murdoch question. each year, the ACLU, because I was national legal director for so long, allows me to come back and harangue the board of directors to please change their policy supporting the current system of campaign financing. And each year I go back and I beg them to change the policy. Each year I lose 60-40 in the board. And each year I lose 60-40 on the board after being asked that question. The argument is, hey, if Rupert Murdoch has all that power, why shouldn't other corporations have the power too? Why should Rupert Murdoch be the only corporation that can speak that way? Or the New York Times should be the only paper? And I think there's a short answer to it. The short answer to it is textual. The short answer is that the only profession mentioned in the entire text of the Constitution is the press. The founders understood that having a vibrant and protected press was crucial for the existence of democracy. Now, if General Motors wants to have a newspaper and become a press, then they can do it too. If a bank wants to found a newspaper or a television station and be the press, they can do it too. But it's functionally defined. It is the functional purpose, the functional role of exercising the press that is protected. And I have no problem at all saying, if you're part of the press, and it's hard to define the press now with the internet and everything, but assuming we can get a definition of the press, I have no problem at all in saying the press is treated better than other corporations. Why? Because they have a special function within the democratic process, and that is to create a mass dissemination of ideas for the population. I'd go further, though. You see, one of the terrible aspects of what we do now is the press clause has been shrunk to virtually nothing. The speech clause does all the work. The Supreme Court has over and over again said the speech clause, the press clause isn't really very important. And indeed, the speech clause has become a kind of colonial clause that's conquered the rest of the First Amendment. And everything is thought of through the lens of the speech clause. We hardly ever, a petition has no meaning anymore outside of speech. We hardly talk about assembly as just a kind of speech. If we were to do what I ask, which is to take all six clauses and say each one of those six clauses is an important component in the functioning of an effective democracy, and each one should be independently developed by the court so that they could fulfill their function, the press clause would all of a sudden be very important. And you know what? We would be asking exactly the question that Will asked me. What is the function of a vibrant press in a robust democracy? And that's the way we should build our constitutional rules governing the press, which means that we should give them privileged access to the prisons, to places that are closed off from public view. The existing rules are press doesn't get treated better than any other speaker. Of course they should be treated better, because they are we count on them to do the institutionalized investigation to get into the dark places and tell us what's happening there. On the other hand, if the press, I'd have to do a little more work to be able to convince you of this, but my belief is that seven or eight large corporations now dominate every single organ of communication that we have in the country. Every newspaper, every internet platform, every movie house, every book publisher, they all funnel into about seven large corporations. That's a disaster waiting to happen. That is the free press clause on the precipice. What we should have is a First Amendment antitrust doctrine that says the press just can't get too big. No single component of the press. When I answer the Rupert Murdoch question at the ACLU by saying, give me the hatchet, let me see if I can cut him up a little bit, because I think it's too big. And what we need are smaller presses with greater diversity of opinion, rather than moving toward a single unified press controlled by seven large corporations. What? So.
Now, the ideas that you're afraid of, the thing that you don't want to happen in 5 years, what can we do right now to prevent that? And is there anything already started that would help prevent that?
Okay, that's a great question. What can we do as citizens, which is, after all, what this festival is about? What can we do to advance our vision of what the First Amendment should be? Let me say first, and this is, I want to start small. I want to start with each of you. Promise me that when you get home tonight, you'll answer Will's quiz. You'll read the Constitution, you'll read the Bill of Rights, and you'll read the First Amendment, so that in conversation with your friends, you will begin to be able to articulate the ideas that I believe, and I think some of you believe. Secondly, you should, and this again, this is seventh grade civics. There's a political way to achieve this. The Supreme Court is split 5-4 on this now. This is not, we don't live in a hopeless world in which nine members of the court are very busy chopping away at the roots of democracy. The court is divided between those members of the court who believe strongly that the First Amendment is essentially an autonomy device that allows people to stand alone and that prevents the community from regulating them, even if what they do harms democracy in a significant way, and four members of the court who believe that regulations designed to protect democracy, while we have to be very careful of them, because the last people in the world I trust to make these regulations are the legislatures, because they have a self-interested a device in getting themselves elected. So you want to look very carefully to make sure that these are not self-dealing rules. But after you've looked at them carefully, if they don't advance one side or the other, then I think that you uphold them. I'm going to say something that is maybe too political for this, but I deeply believe it. The 2016 election is a referendum on what the First Amendment is going to look like for the rest of the 21st century. And it's supposed to be that way. It's supposed to be that way. The lifeblood of the Constitution is the people electing people who appoint judges who reflect the politics and the beliefs of the president and the Senate. These people, judges are not plucked from some isolated notion. They're chosen, and they're chosen by political people, often for political reasons. And so if you don't become involved politically, then you can't complain when the other side appoints judges because they won. Whether you agree with me or disagree with me, I hope you realize and that your friends realize that engagement in the political life of this country is crucial. And it breaks my heart to tell you that if we get 60% voting in a presidential election, we congratulate ourselves on having had a good election. We're so inured to the fact that people don't vote that we tolerate a democracy in which 40% of the eligible voters would rather go to Walmart and shop than vote on election day. And there's something terribly wrong with that. We have to repair that democracy in order for us to go forward.
Not having read your book yet, as I will, I came here because of the title of your talk. The idea of music is that the muses write things. The muses, of course, are connected to divinity. And I know you don't think
I'll tell you, I wanted to title the book Reading the First Amendment as a Poem. My publisher told me I wouldn't sell a single book. So, being utterly without principles, I said, okay, what should I call it? And she said, she's a terrific publisher, New Press is the publisher, she said, call it Madison's Music. It has alliteration, and you'll get people thinking, why music? Why music? So that's what I called it. But if I had my druthers, it would be poetry, not music.
As parents and educators in the room here, can you speak a little bit about civic literacy? What would you say to us going forward?
Well, civic literacy in this country is well nigh a disaster. I mean, there are two forms of literacy that we desperately need that we're not teaching to our people, to our kids. One of them is financial literacy. I have students, elite students at NYU Law School, and they are the best and the brightest, who haven't got the foggiest idea of how checks work and how. They just don't know, and they've never been forced to think about financial literacy, so they don't have any idea about the world that they're about to graduate into and how, you know, what a budget is, what a cash flow is. In part, it's a tribute to the privileged backgrounds that they've never had to ask, but it's also a condemnation of the educational system that we've never forced them. When I was in school, shortly before the Spanish-American War, when I was in school, there was seventh grade civics. And I've written a book called Toward a Return to Seventh Grade Civics. Seventh grade civics was, it was dumbed down. It was not sophisticated. It was a kind of shallow description of the system. But it was wonderful. When you left that year, you understood how it all fit together. Now, you were then in a position to start criticizing seventh grade civics, saying, "Yeah, well, how come it does this, and why doesn't it work?" Seventh grade civics is gone. We don't teach civics anymore, and we don't teach we don't teach much. In our schools, I was going to say, I didn't mean that, by the way. it was your laughter that made it funny. I don't know how to answer it without saying that we've just got to put civics back into the classroom in ways that are easy to do if we would only spend the money. But I don't think I wonder if we have the will to do it. I just don't sense it.
I'd like to know what your feeling is about compulsory voting.
Compulsory voting.
Compulsory voting. What a great question. Compulsory voting. Let's think about that. The last time I raised it at the ACLU, they petitioned to give back the real Burt Neuborne. The suggestion was that aliens had stolen the real Burt Neuborne, and they wanted the original one back when I raised compulsory voting as a possible answer. By compulsory voting, I think you mean, and I mean, reversing the existing norm. The existing norm is an opt-in norm. If you go to vote, you have to opt in to vote, and in a way that's different from virtually every other democracy. Every other democracy, Canada, Britain, France, Germany, every other democracy prepares the voting rolls themselves. The government has the responsibility of preparing the voting rolls, and the voters just show up on election day and vote. Now, it's a little easier in those countries because they don't have the same level of mobility that we have here, but it's clearly easy for us. When we want to find people, for example, when we want to find them for jury duty, or we want to find them for selective service system, when we want to find them for taxes, we find them. when we want to find them for the census, we find them. So we could assemble the voting rolls ourselves and take out one transaction cost. So there would be one less transaction cost for voting. So we have an opt-in system with two transaction costs, registration and voting. And not only that, we're the only democracy that votes on a weekday. Why aren't we voting on a weekend? Why do we vote when working people have to take a day off and make their boss mad? Why are we voting when the couples can't each watch the kid so they can get down to the voting place easily? And so it's just tradition that has us vote on a weekday. It's not written into the Constitution. So we have this double transaction cost and voting on a very inconvenient time. If we were to shift, for example, and move voting, let's say, to Veterans Day, move it to a national holiday and use it as a way to celebrate the gift to us that veterans have made over the years in keeping us free, so that when you vote, you say thank you to them for the privilege. If we were to shift to a national holiday and have it be an opt-out system that says you've got to vote unless you don't want to. If you don't want to vote, no one's going to make you, but you opt out. But if you don't opt out, you have a duty to vote. That's the law in Australia. They have 95% turnouts. It's the law in Belgium. The Chief Justice of Australia told me a hilarious story at the Aspen Institute. I was teaching with him, and he said the Governor General was out of Australia on the last elections 2 years ago, and the Chief Justice felt that since he was the highest ranking member of the government, the Chief Magistrate of Australia, he should not vote on that day. He should stay neutral because his job was to make sure it was a fair election, so he didn't vote. So 6 weeks later, he gets a letter from the local election board saying, Dear Chief Justice, we noticed you didn't vote. Were you sick? Do you have an excuse? Was there some reason? So he writes back and says, Madam, I was the Chief Magistrate of Australia that day and felt that it was necessary for me to maintain my neutrality. And he says, and I got an answer and said, that's nice, dear, £5. So if we went to an opt-out, nobody would be forced to vote, and we would change the turnout rate tremendously overnight.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone.